Hey, kids, we're a couple of annoyed grunt boys, and this is the 138th Simpsons Podcast. That's right, we're the podcast that explores the American animated sitcom The Simpsons from seasons 11 and beyond, and the newest ones when they're available. I say we because I'm one annoyed grunt boy named Steve, and with me, as always, is the other annoyed grunt boy,
Craig.
Hey, Craig, how are we doing this week?
I don't think we should be asking me how I'm doing. How are you doing, Mr. Mexico?
I am great. I just got back. My wife and I went to vacation to Mexico City. It was a beautiful time. We had amazing food, some of the best food in my life. And not just Mexican food. I had a great Italian meal. I had some great Japanese food. And I even had a nice Jewish breakfast. Mexico City is full of lovely people, beautiful warm weather, and just an amazing history and culture. And it's a great vacation. And relevant to this week's episode, people there love their dogs. And it is, I would say, a real dog town.
Hey, that's the title of this episode. Well, it's sad that you don't have any weird story or like horrible things to happen to you or anything like that, which is, I guess, is a good thing, right?
Yeah.
So nothing good for this podcast. Steve, go on another vacation and make sure things fail so you can talk about it on the show, okay?
Okay, next time I go on vacation, I will have a horrible time.
Thank you. That's all we're asking for. We need to look to our social media. Steve, we've had a couple comments, and I think it's time we open the old social media bag. Play the theme. All right, we're going to go to YouTube, Steve. There's a comment from episode 264, that's season 35's episode 11, Frankenstein's Monster, from Carrie Gilgorvik, 9758. Marge should have done something fishy about Homer getting a better job while acting like an expert instead of being more concerned about being able to have a bath in the middle of the day. Remember when Marge just wanted to have a bath in the middle of the day, that episode?
Mm-hmm.
If you remember, Steve, I know it's been a while, but that episode was a Professor Frink secretly helps Homer through a Zoom interview and land a high-level position at a state-of-the-art nuclear plant in Shelbyville.
Yes.
Anyways, Carrie goes on and says, I mean, Marge had been married to Homer for many years, and you would have thought that she knows a lot about him by now.
I mean, I think that, you know, a bath in the daytime is very, like, luxurious, and I think that, you know, Homer would know, like, that's what she wanted.
Yeah, come on, Marge. Get with it.
Yeah.
Carrie then also commented on episode 265, season 35, episode 12. Lisa gets an F1. If you remember, Steve, that was one of our recent episodes. Lisa feels the need for speed as well as the need for control of her anxiety when she becomes a pro kid go-kart racer. Carrie says, I think Homer suits well as Wario. Remember that sequence where Homer is Wario and they're playing Mario Kart in Homer's dream?
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks. Anyways, I think Homer suits as well as Wario because he definitely matched his personality as a reckless driver, which is exactly the problem with Homer, is that he won't listen to people's reasoning or admit that he's wrong or at fault, especially which involved Lisa's anxiety of reckless driving shown at the start of the episode because he's an idiot. But that's the whole point, as this is a popular cartoon and comedy show of all time. It's true. So I guess Wario is on point for being in as Homer's subconscious because I guess if you play the Mario Kart game, it's Carrie's trying to say that Wario is a reckless driver in the game.
Yeah, because Wario is kind of like the evil Mario. And that's not to say that Homer's evil, but Wario is kind of thoughtless and self-involved. And I'm sure there are Nintendo fans out there who have a lot more knowledge of the lore of Wario and Waluigi. But yeah, I think that it tracks that Homer is a real Wario.
That's a shirt right there. Homer is a real Wario.
I like that. That's a good comment. Speaking of season 35, episode 12, I have a comment here from Instagram from Coddill 8341. You know, they've commented before. And they say that water polo is abusive to the horses. Then with laugh emoji. No, it's not. It's they use seahorses, which is a great addendum to a great joke. I probably made that dumb joke about how I don't like water polo because it's cruel to horses, right. But they kindly point out that it's if they use seahorses.
Yeah, Steve loves the water polo joke, but why didn't we think of the seahorses? That's funnier.
Yeah.
Good job.
You know, on the weekends, You know those seahorses? They like to get a little high. You know what they do? They smoke some seaweed.
Yeah, that's good too.
Okay. Alrighty, with that hilarious joke.
You just ruined the... Steve, you just ruined the moment.
I'm sorry, it's what I do best.
Alright.
I just want to crawl back into time, all the way back to, let's say, I don't know, May 21st, 2017. Craig, what was the number one movie in the box office?
That would be Alien Covenant. I believe it's the one where the alien hangs out in a cathedral church, right? Learns about Christ. Yeah. Fun one.
Yeah.
Are the alien movies, like, why do they keep making them? Because there's only Alien, and aliens are the only good ones.
And they're so good. They're, like, some of the best sci-fi horror ever made. Definitively good movies.
Yeah.
I don't know why we need any more. I love David Fincher, but I don't need Aliens Cubed. I don't need the one with the naked white man from Prometheus.
Yeah, I think Alien is kind of like that same, like, it. You just can't find the right movie. And every time there's, like, a new one coming out, like, oh, no, this is going to be as good as Aliens. It's almost like the Terminator franchise. Like, Terminator 1 and 2 are good. The rest, why bother?
I agree.
I would have said the same thing about the Predator movies, because I love Predator 1 and 2. But then Prey came out, and I think Prey is an excellent movie. So I think they figured out how to do a Predator movie finally. It's just, yeah, let's put the next Predator movie, like, you know, in, like, feudal Japan. How cool would that be, like, in the 1600s, right? I would love to see, like, Seven Samurai versus Predator.
That sounds
so
great.
Do it all over the time, yeah.
I know this is already a movie, but I would love to see cowboys.
But done right.
Yeah, exactly. And, like, have the xenomorph come down in Old West times.
Yeah, it'd be a lot of fun. But yeah, I think the Alien Covenant, I don't think I saw this one.
I didn't either.
Well, Steve, I guess we weren't covenanting our aliens in the box office that weekend. But surely we were dancing to the number one song on the Hot Billboard 100.
That's right. And that number one song on that Billboard Hot 100 was I'm the One by DJ Khaled, featuring Justin Bieber, Quavo, Chance the Rapper, and Lil Wayne.
What about our hot rock alternative, Steve?
Oh, well, I don't believe this is a Monkees cover, but it is Believer by Imagine Dragons.
Okay, I'm imagining the dragon. Now what?
Well, see, that's the problem with their name. That's all you can do with dragons. You can only imagine dragons.
Yeah, you can't cook them. You can't hunt them.
You can't eat them and have sex with them.
Well, maybe we were dancing to the country song. What was the country hot 100?
Why, that was Body Like a Back Road by Sam Hunt.
Body Like a Back Road. What's that mean?
I don't know what that means, but it sounds so dirty.
Like, maybe that's what it means. Like, maybe it's just been like, you know what? I think it's about a road that's been used so much, been driven on, been rode on. Maybe that's what it's about. Like, we know it's about a lady because that's what songs are about. Country songs is about ladies or trucks. Or America. But I just think it's probably about too many men have been on his lady, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, Steve, we were probably at the dance club dancing to what song?
Why, that was Something Just Like This. Not like this, but Something Just Like This is the title of the song by the Chainsmokers, Naughty Boys, and Coldplay.
Naughty Boys.
It shouldn't be chain smoking. It's bad for your health.
And you don't want to play out in the cold.
No, you'll catch a cold.
Do you think Chris Martin, like, has a sex dungeon with his partner, Dakota Johnson?
I'm sure, yeah.
Yeah, because she was the sex lady in the sex movies. What are those called?
The 50s AIDS movies.
Madam Web. Yeah.
Himself, yes.
Chris Martin, lead singer of Coldplay, was married to Pepper Potts. Now he's married to Madam Web.
Wow. He's got his own Mary Jimson.
I think next he needs to date Amy Adams. Is she single?
Sure.
How about Gal Gadot? How about...
maybe he can marry Catwoman herself, Halle Berry.
Or Anne Hathaway.
Or Michelle Pfeiffer.
Or Eartha Kitt.
Julie Newmar.
Lee Merriweather.
There it is. All right, Craig. Well, we're not talking about bass. We're talking about dogs. We're talking about season 28, episode 22, Dogtown, in which Homer's court case determines that a dog's life is more valuable than a human's life. And so the canines recognize their new position of power and begin to assert their dominance.
I'm excited for dogs.
Me too. I'm a barking for it. So let's say we've watched the episode.
Okay. Let's say it.
Okay. We'll watch that episode. And we'll be right back. And we're back. Today we're talking about Dogtown, the 22nd and last episode of the 28th season. Originally aired May 21st, 2017. It is episode 618 in the show's run. Your nerd code is WABF15. It was written by J. Stewart Burns, directed by Stephen Dean Moore, and your showrunner is Al G.
Mr. Burns, Mr. Burns, Mr. Burns. Talking about J. Stewart Burns, not the evil bad man Mr. Burns from the cartoon that we talk about every week.
Exactly.
Did you know he got his writing start on Beavis and Butthead? I don't know if we talked about that. We probably have.
Probably, but it is interesting because those are two of like the most iconic cartoons of the 90s.
I worked on the Futurama and then a show called Unhappily Ever After, which if you guys don't remember, the show lasted a few seasons. I think it was on the WB, right?
It was, yeah.
It was like a poor man's version of Married with Children.
Yeah, and I think it was from the same writers as well.
They like reversed it too, because remember like Kelly on Married with Children was like the, what's the proper term I would use for?
Sexually promiscuous.
Yes. And then you had Bud, who was a, always wanting to get laid, but you couldn't, but he was also like a genius.
Mm-hmm.
But then Unhappily Ever After, it was Nikki Cox was the bombshell, but she was smart.
Yeah, she was almost too smart for her whole family.
Yeah, and then the boy character, I think, was just, was he just dumb?
I think dumb and horny, yeah.
Yeah, which is our original name for this podcast. Dumb and horny, the Stephen Craig pun. Yeah, which one's which?
Why not?
Or are we both? And then did they have like a talking rabbit that was Bobcat Goldthwait?
Yeah, and because of that, Bobcat and Nikki Cox were married for a time.
I just remember that. I'm like, she's with him?
Yeah, yeah. It was so weird. I mean, good for him.
But then also, yeah, but then you're also like, so you're saying there's a chance that I could, with my mug, get an attractive lady? And then, yeah, but then she like married, she married Jay Moore. I want to say Jay Moore and Nikki Cox are together or were, or.
That sounds familiar. Yeah, I think you're correct.
And, yeah, I don't know where, Unhappily Ever After. I mean, I watched a couple episodes, but it was, again, it wasn't, like, must-see TV for these eyes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they were married, Jay Moore and Nikki Cox, for, from 2006 to 2018. So, yeah, fair amount of time.
And now look at them, Steve. Look at them.
I'm looking.
Okay, well, J. Stewart Burns, he's credited with 26 episodes. This is the eighth one that we've reviewed. We've done episodes like Holidays of Future Past or Days of Future Future, the Simpson Rama, which I guess it's good that he wrote that because he also wrote on a Futurama.
Mm-hmm.
Flanders Ladder, Treehouse of Horror 30, The Miseducation of Lisa Simpson, right off this episode. So we still got a few more episodes of his to go, actually a lot. I have fond memories of those Days of Future Future and Holidays of Future Past, like, we like those ones, right?
Yeah. Stewart Burns is good at creating those kind of more fantastical episodes that are kind of like larger than life and kind of a bit of a fantasy.
Wasn't Holidays of Future Past, if they were going to end The Simpsons, that would have been the last episode?
Yeah, a lot of people consider that to be like a possible ending point. And I think at the time, too, there were like negotiation issues with Harry Shearer. So it seemed like that could have been the end. But I'm glad it's not because now we have this horrible show that we do.
Yes. Should we just get on with this week's episode, Steve?
Yeah, and so we start off with a couch gag, so I guess that'll be the only thing that we get. The Simpsons family are climbing up a mountain. Homer, Marge, Bart, and Lisa, they arrive at the summit, and on Homer's command, on his walkie-talkie, two Sherpas, who happen to be from Season 9's King of the Hill, not the animated show about Arlo, Texas, but the show, The Simpsons episode, they bring up the couch and the TV, and then one of the Sherpas faints and is taken away by the other, and the family settle in to watch TV. Then Maggie arrives, and she taps Homer's boot with a pickaxe, and he shatters to pieces along with the rest of the family and the couch.
Well, I guess the episode's done then, huh?
Yeah.
I mean, just right onto the episode. But then, in a weird move, I guess, there's a title gag. Was this like their cold open? Because, you know, they're on the mountain. It's also cold.
Oh, good one. Yeah.
Maggie should have said, and live from Springfield, it's Simpsons.
I would like that. That'd be cool.
But yeah, so then Stork flies by carrying Ralph saying, I'm a return. That's kind of fun. It's really weird starting off with the couch, but I think we'll get to see why there's no couch gags.
Yeah.
Okay.
However, this is the second episode ever and the second in a row where there was a couch gag and then more gags because the previous episode, Moho House, comes before the title screen. So I guess they're trying a new thing, maybe try and reinvent something that already works. But we do get a billboard gag, says Tire Fire Barbecue, try our carboiled steak. And it features a sirloin with tire marks on it.
All right, Steve. There, try it. I got it for you.
Oh,
where did it? Yeah.
You know, it's a little rubbery. Mm. Not bad. Still better than Sizzler.
Oh, man, no one knows what Sizzler is. Chalkboard gag, Steve. It says, thank you for 28 great years. Because The Simpsons has been off for 28 years.
Mm-hmm.
But also it says Taylor Swift because she's was 28 at the time.
I don't want to embarrass you, but the airing of this episode will be your birthday. And as a special gift, I called my two friends, Mickey Mouse and Taylor Swift, and I got them together. And so they're going to air the Eras Tour movie on Disney Plus just for you, Craig.
Well, here's the sad thing, Steve. I can't watch it.
Oh, why not?
Because I believe March 14th is the day that Disney will crack down on password sharing.
Oh, no. It's funny how they time that.
Yeah. So, folks out there, you got to start paying for your Disney if you're just leeching off a co-podcaster's account or your friends and family. Yeah. Remember when password sharing was like cool with like Netflix and then Netflix is like, fuck you guys.
Yeah.
And Netflix was like one of the few services I paid for.
Mm-hmm.
And then I only shared it with a couple, I think just like my dad had it. But I like asked him, like, do you even use Netflix anymore? He's like, no. He's like, all right, cool, because I'm canceling, because I never use Netflix.
It's funny, because that seems like the streaming app that started it all, kind of. And yeah, it's also one that I watch the least. Like, it's very rare that, unless, like, some series comes back, it's rare that I even, like, open it up.
And, you know, then I just saw that that Jake Paul is going to box Mike Tyson, and it's going to be a Netflix event. I'm like, oh, man, I just want to see Mike Tyson
kill him.
Beat the shit out. Yeah. I know Jake Paul's like, what, in his late 20s, early 30s or something like that, and Mike Tyson's close to being 60.
Mm-hmm.
But I still think Mike Tyson will just kill him.
Yeah.
Which both are, you know, not great people.
This is true.
But the lesser of two evils, I think. I don't know when. Although, has Jake Paul ever been accused or of sexual misconduct?
Not that I'm aware of. I think he just exploits people, but I don't know. They're both kind of scumbags.
Hmm. Well, we're getting a little too far off the topic, but thank you, Mickey Mouse and Taylor Swift. But, you know, we're doing this whole, you know, Bart gets out of the school and we're going to, you know, Homer pulling the inanimate carpet rod out of his back, right? But it goes right to the episode. You know, we don't actually see Lisa in class or Marge and Maggie at the store. So it's just fun because he's just stuck in traffic coming home from work. So he's using his escape phone app to find a different route. Other apps on Homer's cell phone, which is placed next to his Trackstar 8-track cassette player, which is still in the car. How old is that car now?
I mean, it's got to be like pretty old because it's from like when they like were in high school. So somewhere between 1978 and 2002.
I have a new theory on the car. Is he was probably thinking like when The Simpsons first aired, that car is something Homer purchased new, right? But now I'm thinking like this was like Abe's car that he passed down to Homer and they've just been using it ever since.
That makes sense, yeah.
Steve, what other apps do we got on Homer's cell phone there?
So we have Chore Monkey, a parody of TaskRabbit.
Paid Pal, parody of PayPal.
Where's It, which is another app.
Okay, what's up? It's a parody of WhatsApp.
I love Milhouse's face on that. We have
yeah.
Ribbit, a parody of Reddit.
I mean, isn't Reddit a parody of Reddit at this point?
Yeah, it's such like the shell of what it used to be.
Netflix, which is a parody of Netflix.
And we have The Simpsons Tapped Out, which seems relevant because, you know, we talk a lot about showrunners, but J. Stewart Burns is the game runner to this day of Tapped Out. Yeah.
I wonder what that's like. So he's still writing, right, for episodes?
Mm-hmm. He has one coming out later on next season, actually.
Okay. So is it one of those, like, you know, he goes into work and there's always like that task you have to do, but you got him always like put off. So is it like he's like pitching ideas or breaking a story for like an actual episode, but then like Al Jean or Daddy Matt calls him, is like, hey, I'm looking for that Tapped Out update pitch you got for us. Like, fine, I'll get to it later.
Let's write an episode.
Yeah. You know, we've talked about Tapped Out many times, probably like at least once a week on this podcast.
Seems like it.
Have we asked, you know, listeners if they still play the game? I need you guys
to
comment on Instagram or YouTube just to let us know if you're still on the Tapped Out. Because I remember the last time I attempted to try it with my phone, like I couldn't log into my old account.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no way in hell I'm going to start a whole new game.
Right. And I think when I tried to log in, it took forever to update. And by the time it did, I'm talking like hours, I was just like, screw it.
Right.
Tell us if you're still playing it. And also, I want to know, like, what are the, like, the latest promotions? Like, are they still doing stuff to the newest episode? Like, did Lisa, is like the F1 racing track that Lisa was racing recently, like, is that something you can get now?
Hmm. All right. I'm not downloading, but I'm just going to look at the cover.
Okay.
In the App Store. Right now, just it's a picture of Homer and Krusty.
Hey.
Hey, Steve, it's number 120 on the charts. For adventure, yeah. It says it's only 64 megabytes, but I feel like it took up so much of the of my phone.
Oh, here we go. So the latest update is 4.66.0. So after a disastrous drop in audience approval, Krusty joins forces with a clown cohort led by Little Debbie Dimples to open up a school for the clowning arts. The school is a hit and things are looking cream pie in the sky for Krusty. But Principal Skinner and town leaders don't think it's funny and sue to revoke the school's license. It's up to Krusty and his students to win Skinner over in an all-kidding-aside trial by amusement.
So it sounds like they're in their own, like, pocket universe.
I think so, yeah.
Because your phone's in your pocket all the time, Steve.
That makes sense.
All right. Well, Steve, the app, voiced by, of course, Tress MacNeille, tells Homer to turn left, and he obeys, saying, "You're the driver." He drives into traffic, causing people to call him an idiot and a jerk, and the app once again instructs Homer to turn left, also telling him to pay attention to the road and not look at it/her. Homer replies with a, "Yes, dear," and swerves as oncoming trucks honk at him. Then the app says, "In 50 feet ago, you turn without a signal." So Homer does so, then continues to follow the route, turning left into Garbage Alley.
So in Garbage Alley, Homer finds Sassy's little helper eating out of the trash can. Eating out of another trash can is old Gil. Homer hits the brakes, but his car informs him that there is a brake malfunction and that service is due in May of 2009, that is, 8 years prior to this episode airing. So as Homer continues to hit the brake pedal, symbols appear on his dashboard panel, such as a frowny face inside of a tire, a bird hieroglyph, a party hat with a question mark in it, and an airplane. Homer asks what the hell those mean, but before he can figure out the answer, he realizes that he can't stop. He has to either hit man or dog, a real Snoopy's choice. He says to himself, "I guess your days of eating out of the garbage are over, Gil."
I mean, Homer made the right choice, right?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I mean, that's his family dog, too.
Right, exactly. Like, I don't know, like, I don't have a dog, but if it was between Gil and my cat, I'm hitting Gil.
Now, which Simpsons character, human character, would you hit Santa's little help over? So if it wasn't Gil and it was, say, like Lenny, would you hit Santa's little helper or Lenny?
You gotta say Lenny.
Yeah, not Lenny.
Everybody loves Lenny.
Mr. Burns, you're definitely hitting Mr. Burns.
Yeah. Mo, I think I hit Mo.
Yeah. Barney, I think you wanna not hit Barney just because I think more damage to your car will happen.
It could blow up if all the alcohol.
Yeah. Okay, how about Ralph?
Ooh, here's my hot take. I'm going to hit Ralph. I think Ralph is a little bit too big for his britches at this point.
Well, you also hit Ralph because he's going to say something funny.
That's true. Yeah, he's like, I'm a speed bump. And then goes flying in the air. And then, yeah.
Sure. I'm off to see Grandma.
Nice, yeah.
Something like that, yeah. I'm a Superman. Because he's flying through the air. Yeah, I like mm-hmm. that one.
Yeah.
How about Flanders?
Ooh. See.
He's going to kill Flanders.
He would definitely. But also, I'm not a religious person, but I think in the world, God has Ned on his side. So he'd hit Ned and like it would bounce off of him or something and like he'd be saved. So I think he'd be okay. So you could hit him as much as you want.
Yeah, I think if you have Patty and Selma, he's going to be hitting the Patty and Selma. But then how's he going to explain to Marge?
I mean, that's a good episode. Like,
that really is a good episode.
Marge's all mad at him and he's like, but I tried to save the dog because I love the dog. He's a family dog. And like,
yeah.
That's some emotional weight there. That's pretty good.
Okay. But anyway, so Homer does hit our lovable loser, and the app states that it was never there and that it saw nothing before putting itself into the phone's trash bin. The Simpsons pay visit to an insurance adjuster to see just how much trouble Homer may be in. But after that, they see Gil at the Springfield General Hospital, birthplace of drug-resistant gangrene.
Now, I do have to warn you. If Gil sues, he'll end up with everything you've got.
But that's everything I got.
Okay, kids, give me your best worried looks. Ooh, that's good worry. And Maggie, when we visit Gil, you should think about your mom and me disappearing forever anytime we step behind a wall. Where am I? Where am I? No, seriously, where did I go? It's so dark in here. Maggie!
Oh, Gil, there must be something we can do for you.
That sure is. You could let me scratch your husband.
Sure, but why?
Because you're the lottery ticket I've been waiting for all my life. Bam! Zing!
Before this goes any further, can you just take one look at our darling daughters?
Mr. Gunderson, they don't let saxophones in the ICU, so I'll just tell you the song I wrote for you. B flat, C, D flat.
If memory serves, you have a son.
G,
where's he at?
Like how Gil's just like, I don't want any of Lisa's pity song.
Yeah.
I thought she has taken the sax into the ICU when Bleeding Gloves Murphy, right?
Yeah, I mean, she played it for him. Maybe there's new, like, I guess not code restrictions yet, but like new, like, safety precautions because people smuggling in brass instruments.
Maybe after Lisa and Bleeding Gloves were playing the sax in the hospital, there was like, we can't have this. So they made the new law right after that.
That makes sense, because it is very disruptive to be playing jazz man yeah. while other people are dying.
That, like, maybe there's, like, a surgery going on and it's distracting the doctor performing the surgery.
Too busy tapping their toe and they, like, cut an artery.
Yeah.
So we have Bart, dressed as a female nurse, entering the hospital room saying that he's there to give Mr. Gunderson a shot. Homer whispers to him that the whole putting Gil into a coma idea was just dinner table chatter, and he did not approve. Bart responds that Homer tapped his nose, but Homer swears that he's just scratching it. Bart feels like he has to put something in a coma, so he pokes Homer in the ass with the needle. And Homer sleepily says, why you little? Before he can choke him out, though, Homer passes out. But he wakes up shortly to hear Gil say that he'll see them in court. He then starts scatting, ah, cha, cha, cha. And Marge assumes that that's a good sign because that's what Gil does when he's happy. But he finishes with a cha, cha, ching. Emulating the sound of a cash register.
Uh-oh. So here's some fun trivia, Steve. When Bart is the nurse, apparently that was all improvised by Nancy Cartwright.
That's really interesting. I don't know how well you can, like, the idea of, I know that they do it and, like, Dan does it all the time, but the idea of improvising in a cartoon is still a funny concept to me.
Do they now just put on, like, motion capture suits and then...
I think so, yeah.
That'd be kind of funny if they did. But they don't, Steve. So let's go to the Springfield courthouse, which offers justice for most. The blue-haired lawyer, who we've recently learned is a piss freak, as of a couple episodes ago.
Mm-hmm.
Like he's eating fried chicken out of toilets.
Who doesn't?
Yeah. He tells Judge Snyder that his client, Gil, had just recently turned his life around, stating that his daughter recently bought a washing machine and promised him the box to live in. Do we know Gil had a daughter?
I don't think so.
I think he's always kind of talked about all my kids or something like that.
Yeah. I don't know that we've ever met them, though.
And also, does Blue Haired Lawyer have a name, or is he just still a Blue Haired Lawyer?
I believe that he is still known as Blue Haired Lawyer.
Okay, well, Steve's going to look that up. So as they listen in the court, Bart asks Marge if they can take Homer away forever. Marge assures her son that they just want all the family's money. So Lisa and Bart then each envision a possible future for themselves. Any word on the name?
Looks like he is just known as Blue Haired Lawyer. He is one of both known as Mr. Burns' lawyers. He's usually opposing the Simpsons. He's also worked for Fat Tony, Disneyland, Sea Captain, Frying Dutchman, Sideshow Bob, Roger Myers Jr., Itchy and Scratchy, The Movementarians, Charlie Chaplin, and Jimmy Durante.
Okay, but no name.
No, but he has dated Lindsay Nagel and Cookie Kwan. And he's a Republican.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Well, that's fine, because so are we. All right, Steve, let's go to a clip.
Okay.
Will they send us to live with other families?
Miss Simpson, from now on you shall live with us, receiving musical instruction from Mr. Adolf Sachs himself.
Woohoo!
Adolf, a name that will only be associated with beautiful music.
We'll be free to do whatever we want. $1,000 a kidney? Take them both. Ay, caramba!
What I really like about that scene, at least of course, was great because, you know, that's what she thinks is going to live in some fancy castle life. Music from Adolf. But then, like, Bart's just like his like, he has the wherewithal of, like, okay, I know you can sell kidneys to get money.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to sell both of them. And then he knows in his fantasy that he's going to die anyway from. It's just silly.
It is. I like it when your fantasy is smarter than you are as a person.
Yeah.
Bart's tombstone says, student of life, but not of anatomy, which proves his point. And then we get some other tombstones, such as Frank Grimes, which says grimy, Maud Flanders, which reads beloved weirdo, and Dr. Nick, who at the time was dead, I think he's back now, which just says patient, Edna Krabappel, which says ha, iconic. And then we have Miss Emile Mercer, school librarian, who is quoted as saying, I regret that I've got nothing to regret.
That sounds like a regret right there. Oh, yeah, it is a regret.
I regret that. I'll regret that.
But it, then also in Bart's memory, he has made sure he's concocted tombstones.
That's true, yeah.
Of dead people. That's funny.
So Homer takes a stand where the blue-haired lawyer accuses him of deliberately driving his car into his paycheck. I mean, client. Nope, paycheck is better. When asked what his defense was, Homer says that he had no other choice because he didn't want to hit the dog. The people in the courtroom, who include a jury made up of Comic Book Guy, Cookie Kwan, Bumblebee Man, Moe, Dr. Hibbert, Lindsay Nagel, Helen Lovejoy, Hans Molman, Cletus, Captain McAllister, and Seymour and Agnes Skinner, all say aw at the thought of a dog.
Aw. Well, members from the crowd state that people love dogs, and Homer's lawyer, Maxwell Finch, that's his name, Steve, he actually has a name, unlike Blue-Haired Lawyer. So that's his second appearance of Maxwell Finch, who's appeared in this season, season 28, ninth episode called Last Traction Hero. I don't think we've reviewed that one yet.
Not yet.
He's since shown up in two more episodes, season 30's Girls in the Band, which we did review. It's our 121st episode. And I'm Just a Girl Who Can't Say Doe, also from that season, season 30. Not reviewed that one either. So anyways, Maxwell assures Homer that he is on his side, which delights him. You know, the case goes on, and with Bart representing the defense.
Now go ahead, son. You tell us how you got your dog.
It was Christmas, sir. We saved him, and he saved us. Now we love the dog, and the dog gives us all the love we could handle. Love.
Aww.
Could the stenographer read that last part back with sentimental music?
The dog gives us all the love we could handle. Love.
Thus, the defendant asked this court to believe that in order to avoid hitting a dog, it is acceptable to hit a human? My client?
It's looking good, homie. According to our consultant, the toughest nut to crack is juror number 6.
Aw, good doggy.
Ladies and gentlemen, this man is a human being just like you or me. Surely his life has more value than some creature that scoots its buttocks along the ground.
Aww.
or gets its head stuck in an empty pickle jar.
Aww.
I love the Cockney accent that Bart does, and then also the stenographer doing it as well.
And the music in the background swelling up is great. Yeah, Nancy's having fun here. We got Bart as the nurse, kind of putting on a little accent there, too.
Yeah, it's just gets to flex their muscles a little bit. It's good.
Yeah.
So the blue-haired lawyer continues his comparison of a man versus dog, citing a canine walking on a hot sidewalk in a way that suggests it's dancing. The jury once again responds with an aww, which Gil finds ridiculous, arguing that he's a human being, not just some dumb animal. The jury is taken aback by this comment, and from the stands, Sideshow Mel speaks up asking who Gil is calling dumb. The dogs who sniff for bombs at the airport? The St. Bernards who save lives at the slopes of St. Moritz? He then asks about a third dog, and then holds up a tablet which shows a video of a puppy appearing to play the Maple Leaf Rag on a player piano.
Well, after the courtroom reacts positively to the video, Judge Snyder tells the jury that there's more sanctity in a dog's loyalty than there is in all your human laws. Quoting the Bible, the sketch artist draws Homer with a halo over his head and then Gil hanging from a noose. There's our tattoo, right?
That's it.
Well, Judge Snyder then asks the jury to make a decision.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, how...
Not guilty.
Case dismissed.
We won! It's all because of you, boy. I have never been more glad that I didn't hit you with my car, secretly bury you, get another greyhound painted your exact coloring, then realize it's a girl, stick on a fake wang, and pretend that she's you for however long dogs live.
Aww. That was confusing to me.
What?
The whole statement, like, he buried the dog, replaced it, even though we didn't get it, and then he got a female dog, painted it the exact same color, put on a fake wang. So is that nuts, Santa's Little Helper?
No, he's saying, like, if he did kill Santa's Little Helper, that's what he would have done.
Gotcha. Okay. I was dumb. I was like, what? Okay, that makes sense now. That's what he would have done.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm an idiot. Okay.
Do we need to cut this from the podcast so people don't know you're an idiot?
No, they already know. It's fine.
Okay.
So the jury carries Homer out of the courtroom on their shoulders as he asks them to take him and the real Santa's Little Helper, the only one, to the dog park. They do so, cheering. Gil walks out behind them saying that he's been through a lot, but he's always believed that people cared more about a human being than a dog. We then hear Homer say that he forgot his phone charger, and so the crowd returns with him on his shoulders, trampling Gil. With the charger, they leave the courtroom once more, again stepping all over Gil. Homer discovers that that charger isn't his, and so they go to the courtroom a third time and once again walk all over Gil for a third time as well. Later, Kent Brockman reports on the case, which offers some commentary from ESBN talking head Anger Watkins.
It's now official. A Springfield jury has decided that the life of this greyhound is more valuable than the life of this greyhound station inhabitant.
Look at me. I'm a big man. A big man. Anybody got a quarter? Gotta be a quarter, not two dimes and a nickel. That ain't worth jack.
What's your take on all this, Anger Watkins?
I'm angrier than a beehive in a paint mixer. This is the craziest legal decision ever made outside of Arizona. What's next? Cats get credit cards? Let a snail race in the Indy 500? Like that stupid movie Turbo? I tried to inhale nitrous oxide to get fast. I ended up naked behind an appliance stall. Lies! Lies! Lies!
We've seen Anger Watkins in a couple episodes. He's fairly new to the Simpsons universe, isn't he?
Yeah, I think he is the take on ESPN's Stephen Smith, who is a commentator who tends to be very very loud and very angry in the same manner. But it's interesting that he's also a news commentator as well. They just kind of put him in wherever they ever. But, you know, Turbo, you know, it's got Ryan Reynolds, Paul Giamatti, and Maya Rudolph. I don't know. I've never seen it, but maybe it's not as bad as he says it is.
Yeah, I don't think I'm... You really caught up on those Pixar movies. It's a Pixar, right?
I think it's a DreamWorks, actually.
Oh, DreamWorks. Oh, geez.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe one of these days we'll never watch it, Steve. How about that?
That sounds good. We'll put that on the Patreon. Not watching DreamWorks films.
So the sign at the First Church of Springfield reads, "A mighty fortress is our dog." And Homer assures Santa's little helper that he'll get 10 walks a day, adding that he can even bite the mailman. So a couple walk up to Homer, calling him America's number one doggy daddy. And Santa's little helper squats to take a shit. And Homer offers the woman to do the honor of picking it up, when she responds with an enthusiastic, "Would I?" And then Homer says that that's what he asked. Would she? Like, doesn't understand the nuance of the "would I?"
Mm-hmm.
It's great. So another man pulls up in a car to take a picture of Homer, saying that he's the greatest man that he knows one thing about. And then a line of cars honk and cheer, holding up signs such as "the pause that refreshes,"
"I own a dog and I vote,"
"it's not anti-cat to be pro-dog,"
"let mutts sniff butts."
And that's it. There's no other signs.
Ah, Craig, there's one.
And death to squirrels. That car, those people need to be murdered, Steve.
I don't disagree with you. And, you know, I don't like to get in the cat versus dog debate. Speaking of dogs versus other animals, I'm also pro-squirrel. And I vote multiple times, sometimes if George Soros pays me enough. But I am a cat owner. I like cats and I like dogs. What I don't like are dog owners. Not all of them. Most of them are lovely people, but there's a sense of entitlement and main character personality that dog owners have that I just don't really love. So I don't want to get anybody mad. And if listeners, you have a dog, more power to you. Just be mindful that your dog doesn't need to go shopping with you everywhere. And people don't care about your dog as much as you think they do. That's all. That's end of rant. I'm sorry.
Yeah. And that goes for you people that have children.
That's also true. Yeah.
No, I mean, look, I think discussed this many times on the podcast. You know, if you got a service animal, perfect. Awesome. Yeah,
totally.
It's the people that abuse the power. And also you're being dishonest with everyone else. Like, oh no, this is my helping scene or my service dog when it clearly isn't. But we're not the policemen, Steve.
No, we're not in government. But you know who is? Mayor Quimby. And from his office, he witnesses the voters' response to the case and asks an aide on their current position on dogs. The government official answers, and it shocks Diamond Joe.
"We currently have a city employee who rounds them up and puts them to sleep."
"What? I can't believe such a jerk would even be elected dog catcher. From this point forth, this town will be known as the dog-loving capital of the world. That'll put Springfield on the map."
"Yeah, why aren't we on the map?"
"I don't know. I made 20 calls to Rand McNally. They don't even know what state we're in. Thanks to these hastily passed, untested, pandering laws, Springfield is now the most dog-friendly city in America."
Yay!
Arf.
Another great Simpsons Springfield, where Springfield joke.
Yeah, I like that they threw it in. That's still fresh. Yeah, good stuff.
A sign is hung on the courthouse that says, "Welcome to Springfield Pooch Paradise." And dogs appear all over the town, and even local canine-friendly businesses begin to appear, such as Bones and Noble, Puppy Gap, and Abercrombie and Fetch. As the pups are released from the dog pound, its sign is cut into two, and more letters are added, making it say Dog Playground.
That's fun. That's creative. I like that.
Which is a strip club that Steve and I used to go to, Dog Playground.
It was rust. But you know what I always had? A boner.
And the dancers kept sniffing your crotch, Steve.
Yeah.
And it was really mean of you to bring that laser pointer. Okay.
So Krusty the Clown and Rainier Wolfcastle, their game of frisbee is in the park, and it's interrupted by a pooch taking their flying disc.
Can we just dissect that scene real quick?
Sure.
Why is Krusty hanging out with Rainier Wolfcastle, and why is it they're playing frisbee? Like, they don't have a dog, right? They're just in the park playing frisbee?
You know, maybe they both, got done with their taping at Channel 6, and, Krusty's like, "Hey, I could do a bunch of drugs, or I could hang out with this Austrian guy, and we could go to the park and play frisbee."
Okay.
I don't know. It is weird.
Krusty doesn't seem the type that would, want to be around anyone. Well, I think you're right. It's probably he's trying to be friends with Rainier Wolfcastle because of status, right?
Yeah, although given the history of Rainier Wolfcastle's people and the history of Krusty's people, They do seem like an unlikely friendship.
But I love that, you know, that their religion doesn't interfere with their friendship.
That is very nice, yes. It's unity. It's like Queen Latifah rapped about. Meanwhile, at the Rover's Palace Casino, we see some dogs playing poker, a la the famous painting. Then we see dogs playing keno and dogs playing blackjack. On the other side of the town, Mario wields a cleaver chasing a dog that stole several sausages from his meat shop. You know, that meat shop that Mario always has? Because he's that butcher, Mario, the Italian butcher. But the Italian business owner is captured by Chief Wiggum with a net and thrown into the Springfield People's Catcher van. Marge steps into the hair salon to find that all the chairs are occupied by dogs getting new dues. When it's her turn, she finds that her style resembles that of a dog as well.
Very cute, Marge.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Ned Flanders walks to the good old Quickie Mart with his dog, Baz, and finds that other dogs have torn the convenience store apart. He asks Apu, "Hey kids, remember Apu? He's back." In this episode. He asks if there's anything that the dogs haven't gotten into, and Apu says, the dog food. And as a pup steals a wiener from the hot dog roller. Meanwhile, in this clip, licensed DVM, not DMV, that's across the street, Lionel Budgie is arrested. But it's not sure why.
Why are you shutting me down?
You made a dog wait for a teeth cleaning while you saved a racehorse's life?
You call yourself a veterinarian, huh?
And you know what we found inside? Dogs in cages. That's no way to treat man's best friend. Lock him up. In a cage. Like a dog.
Don't you understand? Dogs are born to follow and obey. The moment the pack realizes that humans are no longer their masters, thousands of years of domestication will fall away. They'll revert to their wild wolf nature.
Well, then I guess you'll be happy being nice and safe in jail.
Oh, yes, please. Take me there now. You're all doomed. Doomed.
Hey, that's Lionel Budgie. It's voiced by star of Logan's Run, The Island of Dr. Moreau, and the Austin Powers movie series, Michael York, reprising his role of the Orville Redenbacher-looking veterinarian. It's his third appearance, first showing up in season 27's Lisa the Veterinarian, our episode 123. Then Pork and Burns from season 28, our 109th episode. He also appeared in season 30's A Girl Who Can't Say Doe, and the second half of season 31's Warren Priest, which was our first episode of this year.
Yeah, we like Michael York, one of the few non-main cast members that has a recurring character. It's just his voice is so, you know, that's not how he talks, obviously, but like that old man voice is just so good.
It's really good, yeah.
I need to go back and rewatch Logan's Run. It's one of my favorite movies. I haven't watched it in years.
Neither have I, and like, it's a great movie.
And that is allowed, if we ever do the Patreon, that's allowed to be talked about on our Patreon because Michael York does voices on The Simpsons.
Very true. It's awesome, yeah.
I don't think we've discussed that, our rules about watching movies, right? If we do the Patreon on this podcast.
Yeah, I think we have such strict rules about a thing that doesn't exist, but...
which we haven't done yet. But yeah, like the idea is like when we talk about a movie, is that it's only because like there's someone that has a connection in that movie. Well, it'd be like an actor or even like, you know, a writer or heck, even try to find anyone who's like worked on The Simpsons is also associated to a movie that we want to talk about.
Right, right. So we could do like obviously Spinal Tap, but we could do, say, The Devil Wears Prada because Anne Hathaway was in an episode of The Simpsons.
Yeah. I mean, I really want to talk about Maximum Overdrive, which stars like a main cast member of The Simpsons, Yardley Smith, you know, pretty much like. Probably the easiest thing to do because we can talk about any movie because there's probably some connection from The Simpsons to any movie ever. It's like it's the new 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, right?
Exactly. Yeah. It's 6 degrees of Homer's Bacon.
There we go. I like it.
Yeah.
All right. But the problem is why we haven't gotten the Patreon off the ground is like, what movie do we start with? You know,
It's so hard to choose. And fans tell us and we probably won't do anything with it, but tell us.
Yeah. Email us at 13simpsons@gmail.com or just leave a post somewhere on Instagram or YouTube.
That's right. But speaking of Homer's bacon, we're at the next morning where Homer's enjoying breakfast and Bart tells him that Santa's little helper didn't come home from the previous night. But Homer's not surprised because if Bart were a dog, would he come home these days? Because look at how well they're treating him. He then compares the current situation to the canine afterlife when the family dog, not that one, finally does return, Homer makes a joke that is certainly worth the effort.
It's like doggy heaven out there, only real.
Doggy heaven isn't real?
No, no, it's real. The dogs all have harps and wings.
How do they play harps if they don't have fingers?
Dogs have fingers in heaven.
How do you know so much about dog heaven?
I died for 5 minutes and was sent there by mistake. Now leave me alone. Ooh, come on, girl. Ow, ow, ow. Just get him by the collar. You can do it. Come on, don't bite me. Come on, pull. Come on.
Dad, we don't have time for this.
Quiet. I'm doing something important. There you go. Yes, that's it. Well, well, well. Look what the cat dragged in.
Worth it.
Totally worth it.
I know.
What was going on in that clip, Steve?
A Homer grabs Snowball 2 and put its claws around the collar of Santa's little helper to pull the dog into the house just so he could say, look what the cat dragged in. I just like the belabored joke of, like, he sees the humor and, like, I gotta make this joke.
Yeah.
Even if it's not funny, just having to make that joke just for the sake of it.
Have you actually had to say, look what the cat dragged in your life?
In my life, yes, because we did at one point have an indoor-outdoor cat, and, you know, he probably thought that we weren't the best hunters, because sometimes he'd bring in mice or birds for us, and so, yeah, we would have to be like, oh, look what the cat dragged in.
And they were dead, of course.
Yeah, not the cat, but the animals.
We don't have a cat, but there's, like, a backyard cat, like a neighborhood cat that used to come around all the time when we pet it, and I remember one time I was opening the door to the outside, and there's like a dead bird right there. Then pretty sure the cat just like gifted us, which was nice. It's like, hey, you know, thanks for the pets. I brought you this bird.
Mm-hmm. Kind of sweet.
Yeah, I haven't seen that cat in a while. I see it, but you know, it's just a little bit more mature. Isn't as funny or, you know, as friendly. Still friendly, but doesn't come on our deck or really care about us anymore. It's sad.
Sad.
It's probably because I pay more attention to the other critters in the neighborhood, right? The squirrels and the birds. It's probably, yeah. That guy's a traitor.
It does feel like a betrayal to be like, oh, you're gonna feed my food.
Yeah. Well, hey, there's plenty of bird seed. You eat that, cat.
Yeah, come on. Maybe you'll eat enough bird seed so your breath is like bird seed, so birds will come and just fly into your mouth.
Can we talk about how fun the Nancy Cartwright as Bart's sadness, like the sadness in Bart's voice.
Yeah, about doggy heaven.
Yeah. Did you ever have to, like, your parents ever have to explain the death of a pet? That analogy of, like, taking the dog to a nice place upstate at a farm, like, was that ever in your wheelhouse growing up? Learning about death, essentially.
Right, right. So I know that there's like the Rainbow Road and like taking the dog to the farm upstate or whatever. I never had that. I remember my first pet that died is I had a hamster named Alf, and it died because it was a hamster. It cost $1.99, and you know, I don't know how long hamsters are supposed to live. But I came home from school one day, like it was probably first grade, and my mom just sat me down and said, like, your hamster died. And she didn't sugarcoat it.
Well, that'd be gross if she sugarcoated your hamster.
That would be kind of weird, like, but we eat got dessert. My hamster balls. It might seem harsh and cruel to be so direct, but I kind of have a better relationship with death now, I think. So maybe it worked out. I don't know. How about you? Did you ever have to, like, did you ever get, like, that talk about, like, oh, it's gone to a different place?
I don't really remember. I just think, like, I was surrounded by death a lot as a little kid.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds really morbid, but like in the fence, like three of my grandparents died with like one every year, like when I was like from like age 3, 4, and 5. So I think that was kind of like grandpa's dead. And it's like, oh, okay. Like, I don't really remember cause I don't think I was at the funerals for any of them cause I was so young.
Mm-hmm.
But I understood, like, okay, well, we can't go to Grandpa's anymore because he's gone. All right. So then when, like, our family dog died, I was, you know, probably 9 or 10, so I pretty much understood.
Yeah, it's tough, and I don't know, like, how you as a parent can, like, you know, how a parent comes up with, like, the thing to say, because it's got to be difficult. Like, I remember my uncle, Jesse, he was living at this house with some other people, and their goldfish died, so he just bought, like, a bunch of other goldfish. And so every time the goldfish would die, he just replaced it so that his other niece, Stephanie, I think, she would just, like, she wouldn't even know.
I'm pretty sure it was your niece, Michelle, not Stephanie.
You're right, that's right, that's right.
Yeah. She was kind of annoying because she kept saying, like, how rude to you a lot.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, Stephanie did.
Right, right. And then Michelle was like, you got it, dude.
Yeah, she was really annoying.
Mm-hmm.
But I like her sister.
Oh, yeah.
Her younger sister, Elizabeth.
Right. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Magical.
She's very, yeah, Marvel. She's very marvelous, Steve. Dumb. Steve's, of course, referring to Full House. And I was, of course, referring to Elizabeth Olsen, the Olsen twins, her sister. But I'm pretty sure my mom did that to me as a kid.
Really?
Because I had this goldfish when I was younger that lived like a year or something like that.
Wow.
I guarantee you that goldfish did not live a year.
Yeah, you wouldn't know.
No, so it's like, I probably was at school. She probably noticed in like the room, like, oh, there's a dead goldfish. Well, I'll just go and buy a new one, you know, because they're 20 cents.
Exactly, yeah. Probably easier to just take the drive to the mall or wherever.
Yeah.
To spend the quarter. Then have to deal with the emotional fraught of a child losing a goldfish.
Even though I've lost like 3 grandparents by then.
But a goldfish is different.
That's true.
It needs some water.
That's when my grandparents are dead. They couldn't swim. Now, is it true that your grandfather was on the Titanic, Steve?
That's very possible, actually. Yeah, in 1912. Yeah, that's actually tracks.
All right. But with your father, right? Like,
yeah, yeah. Okay. The graduation present.
All right. Steve, we're going back to The Simpsons, okay?
Okay.
So the dogs run amok all over the city, leaving their mark on every inch of Springfield. And at the Van Houten household, their Cholula, Taquito, digs up Luann's dahlias. Kirk tries to stop him with a spray bottle, but the dog just growls in return. Kirk begs not to be hurt, exposing his belly as a sign of submission, and Taquito continues to growl, which causes other dogs to do the same. So all the pups, including Laddie, remember Laddie? Mm-hmm. They form a pack and cause even more chaos, such as breaking into Cossington's to steal a TV.
What's a dog gonna do with a TV?
I don't know, watch episodes of Dog the Bounty Hunter?
Oh, yeah. They're like, this is disappointing.
Not because his name is Dog, just... The show's kind of disappointing.
Yeah, exactly.
Sad to watch.
Kind of a bummer. So, Taquito, he's appeared in a few episodes, such as Bart's Comet, Radioactive Man, and 22 Short Tales About Springfield. But this episode, Dogtown, that we're watching, is the first episode to reveal his name, and he's added as a regular recurring character. So, probably at this point in 2017, he probably also showed up in Stapped Out.
Yeah, the name Taquito... Is it problematic?
That's a good question. I think that, you know, it goes back to the old Taco Bell commercials, Yokiro Taco Bell with the Taco Bell Chihuahua, and the kind of stereotype of Mexican folks and dogs. Just like, it is reductive, I think.
I love a taquito.
I mean, it's about as far as from traditional Mexican food as you can get, but it is delicious. And
how would you know about traditional Mexican food?
Oh, you know, I just... Not like I've been there or anything.
Do you prefer a beef, a chicken, just a cheese? What are you going for, Steve?
I tend to go for chicken, but they're all good. What about you?
I think I'm a ground beef type of guy.
Solid. It's a classic.
I found a new Taco Tuesday restaurant that we're going to be frequenting now. So
ooh, very nice.
They're $2 a taco, and they load it. It's not like skimpy.
Oh, that's good.
Like
it's crunchy shell?
You could get crunchy or soft. I think soft because they load more toppings on it because they just lay out all the toppings and you fold it yourself, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
But like it feels like it's half a pound of meat in one taco.
Oh, wow. That's good.
Yeah. I'm just really hungry right now, Steve. Sorry.
I want
to eat a chihuahua. You know, I'm not much of a dog guy. Like dogs are fine.
Mm-hmm.
But the Chihuahua is just the most annoying dog out there.
It's the problem with these smaller dogs is they feel the need to prove themselves. So they're more vocal, more yappy. And so, yeah, their personality just doesn't really like... I'm sure there are lovely smaller dogs like And I'm sure they're lovely chihuahuas, but yeah, they are kind of, they can be annoying.
Yeah, as I've said, if I'm ever getting a dog, I'm getting a big dog. Mm-hmm. Like those t-shirts, big dog. They're big. Do they still make big dog?
Probably not. I mean, maybe there could be like a Gen Z, because Gen Z loves dressing like the 90s.
Right.
And so, like, they think that Nirvana is a clothing brand, so they probably think the Big Dog or some, like, band from the 90s. Like, oh, yeah, my dad used to listen to the Big Dogs. So, Craig, back to the show. As a hound on a white horse howls at the moon, calling to his doggy brethren, a drunken Homer leaves Moe's. He puts his keys into what he thinks is the ignition, but finds that his car won't start. So the camera zooms out, and we see that he's actually put his key into a parking meter, and he thinks that the expired time on the meter is actually an empty gas gauge. So he decides to walk home instead, thinking that it'll be safer. So he talks about all the health benefits of walking, saying that he's going to live longer. And then we see a predator looking at him in red tones. The hunter runs towards Homer, but he's distracted by a fire hydrant, which it pisses on. Homer turns around and sees a pack of growling dogs following him.
Hey, here come some of my four-footed friends. I guess you want to meet the guy who's responsible for making all your lives better. Okay, wait a minute. Let me guess. Collie, Dachshund, Tibetan Mastiff, Otterhound, Swedish Fellhund, Finnish Spitz, Norwegian Lundhund, Catahoula Leopard Dog, Legato Romagnola, and three wolves!
Homer knows his breeds.
Yeah, that's a thing I don't know anything about. Like, breeds.
Yeah.
You know, when people just, like, nonchalantly just name breeds. I'm like, where do you study, a dog book or something? Like, yeah, that, like, I don't get it.
That's clearly an Alaskan hound.
Yeah.
I can't even name a fake pound. I can't even name it. Like, that's clearly a Irish setter.
Yeah.
The wearing a kilt? How do I know?
Who's learning dog breeds? Like, I just don't get it.
Yeah.
I guess you people are smarter than us, which is true. So Homer grabs a Dachshund and points it at the other dogs like it's a gun, right? And he waves the wiener dog, telling the pooches to stand back. And so the dog bites Homer, but he stands brave, saying that he's not scared and that their bark is worse than their bite. Then the dogs start barking loudly, which Homer finds to be horrible. So he runs, and the wild pack chases after him with a Dalmatian puppy close behind.
Meanwhile, in the prison, Dr. Budgie sits in the cell, muttering to himself in the third person, saying that he warned them. He warned all of them. Irritated with the vest chatter, Chief Wiggum attempts to go inside the prison cell, but he's too fat. So he tries to turn sideways, but it's no use. So he calls for Lou to get the bar butter, then blames the fact that they bought European prison cells. And some bar butter, that sounds tasty.
Like, I just, in my mind, it's, I'm going to a bar, I'm sitting at the bar, ordering a drink, and instead of handing out, like, free peanuts or beer nuts, they give you butter.
Just pats of butter.
Yeah. I could see you being like, I'm just going to eat this butter.
I wouldn't hate that. Yeah.
You know, they're shaped like those little Andes chocolates, right? Those little... So you might as well just eat the... They should have, like, a butter candy. Not butter... Like, I know there's butterscotch, but, like, it's the consistency of, like, those Andes candies, right? Mm. But it just tastes like butter. Like, it was, like, melted butter in your mouth.
I know you're joking, but that doesn't sound horrible to me.
Like, what if it, like, along with that, it also has, like, the flavor of, like, sourdough, mm-hmm. maybe? So it's like you, but then your mind's like, why am I not eating bread? But it tastes like buttered bread.
Maybe it's carb-free for those folks who don't like that. So, yeah, this is a good idea.
It's like, all right, I'm going to go to the test kitchen, the annoyed grunt boy test kitchen, and work on a solution or something.
I'll see.
We'll figure it out, Steve. Anyway, so Homer arrives home with the wiener dog on his back. He throws it out of the kitchen windows and instructs the kids to lower the purge armor. And Lisa reminds her father that they don't have any purge armor. And Homer remembers that he always means to buy it the day after the purge, which it's cheaper. Does this establish that the purge exists in the Springfield universe, Simpsons universe?
It sounds like it. Yeah, like every year it's probably happened for who knows how long, probably whenever the first movie came out. I could see that being a thing that the people of Springfield go crazy with, like Mo with his, you know, his whale. And, you know, he's got a lot of shady dealings. So he would, like, have a lot of fun with the purge. Krusty probably does a bunch of drugs. I could see a lot of Springfielders kind of going ham on the purge.
Now, have you ever seen the movie The Purge or any of the sequels?
No, I have not.
Either have I. And it's one of those movies when I heard about the concept, I'm like, that's a really good concept for a movie. Mm-hmm. But I'm also a scaredy cat because, like, the concept and the idea of the Purge frightens the hell out of me. I know how, like, you're afraid of jail, which rightfully so. Mm-hmm. But the idea of the Purge happening, I can see a world that it might come true.
Yeah.
And it scares me. Like, that idea kind of scares me.
Yeah, because you want people to just be cool and just, like, get high and do whatever. But, yeah, people are going to be jerks and they're going to do bad things to other people. And that is, the more you think about it, you're totally right. It's more frightening. Yeah, that's kind of horrifying.
Because you can straight up murder someone and it's fine.
Yeah, and do other bad things. That...
Yeah, so like if the Purge existed, again, never seen the movies, but I'm assuming there's probably people like me that just will like lock down the house, like hide in an attic or, you know, like
yeah,
a safe room. That's what I would be doing.
I'd be downloading MP3s on Napster.
Okay. You're right. I'd just be illegally downloading movies, music, and a car. Exactly. And cars. Maybe, like, drive it to, like, the middle of the forest and where no one's around and just camp. But see, you don't know if someone's going to be there because they'll be like, that's the perfect place to murder someone, too.
Yeah, I think locking into your own house is probably the best move and then just...
But what if someone who really hates you knows that's going to happen and they can just set your house on fire with you in it? Yeah. It doesn't matter.
Man, you got me all scared of the Purge now.
Now, is there any connection to The Simpsons with the Purge movie?
Let's see.
All right. Well, Steve, that looks it up. I'll go back to The Simpsons. Marge is asking what's going on, and Homer informs her that the dogs have taken over the town. So Santa's little helper, here's a howl. And Bart begs him to resist the call of the wild, much like he did when they assigned that book for summer reading. Was that a book that you had to read, Call of the Wild?
It was a book I was supposed to read. I think I read it, but I barely remember.
Yeah, I don't think so. I don't remember much of the books we had to read. That shows you our school system, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Santa's little helper runs for the doggy door, and Homer stands in the way. The pup jumps in Homer's shirt, tickling him, which he's done before, until he escapes. Bart sadly says that they lost him in the pack, but Homer is certain that he's a good dog who would never turn against the family. Lisa then notices that Santa's little helper is ripping the stuffing out of the car seats. Homer responds by, you know, eating Santa's little helper's dog food, which he's, you know, wanted to threaten Bart to do before. But after a few bites, Homer starts to enjoy it. And that's kind of what happened before, too. So Homer likes dog food.
Yeah, he's kind of enjoying that, isn't he?
Mm-hmm.
So as the wolf howls in the playground of Springfield Elementary, Superintendent Chalmers aims a rifle he got from the school's lost and found.
Great.
It's kind of a, yeah, but also, who brought that gun to school? I'm just going to assume it's Ralph. He just took it from his dad.
Yeah, I was going to say maybe Nelson.
Yeah, that's the obvious answer, but I'm going to stick with Ralph.
Okay, I like Ralph.
As he shoots, Skinner comments that not one student showed up to school just because a pack of ferocious, masterless dogs are roaming the playground. Chalmers shoots again, accidentally hitting Gil. They sent Willie to deal with the horde of hounds, but it turns out that the groundskeeper has just joined the pack, crawling around naked on all fours, feeling accepted for who he truly is. Which I guess this makes sense, because remember when he was greased up when Bart brought Santa's little helper to school that one time?
Oh, yeah.
And Santa's little helper liked that greased up Willie.
Who doesn't love a greased up Willie?
Over at Springfield Town Hall, an emergency meeting is held. So the topic is second thoughts. Outside of the meeting, Lou and Wiggum stand guard while Clancy's wearing a full dog bite suit.
How come I don't get a dog proof suit?
Because I smell like lamb, Lou.
Very well. You were right, and we were wrong.
Yes. Can you remove the shackles?
Don't push your luck.
These dogs, they walk around all high and mighty, no regard for anyone else on the planet. I mean, that's humans' job.
Repeal the stupid new laws!
Yes, repeal the dog and child labor laws. Fine, just the dog ones.
I say status, you say
quo!
So passed. Well,
Everything's back to normal again.
It's a pity no one told the dogs that.
Huh? What?
You fools have surrendered your position as alpha dogs. Until you reassert human dominance, it is you who will be calling these savage canines master. Who among you is brave enough to tame this slobbering horde?
Well, I guess it's up to old Gil.
I thought Gil was shot.
Maybe he's like a Gil 1000.
The attracts.
Mm-hmm. I like Mo being like, where do these people get off thinking they're the most important thing in the world? That's for deaf people's job. So Marge asks Gil why he's helping the people that think so little of him. And he explains that he's doing it to show that he's not the town failure. Barney chimes in, assuming that he was the town failure. But Mo says that he's not even that. Poor Barney. Gil asks who will come with him, and the townspeople all chant, "None of us." And he says, "One more time," and the crowd says, "Nobody." He adds, "I can't hear you." And they respond, "Yes, you can." So Homer defends Gil, saying that he is someone they all agreed is less than a dog. He then pleads with people to stand behind Gil as he redeems himself, even though he did nothing wrong. The crowd chants, "Gil, Gil, Gil." And then a shadowy figure, who looks kind of like McGruff the Crime Dog, is in a trench coat, but he stands back and watches the meeting. But it turns out just to be two dogs standing on top of one each other.
All right, so back at the Simpsons home, Bart is determined to get Santa's little helper back. But Grandpa thinks it's too dangerous, demanding that the kids stay put. And Bart hits a button on the heater, raising the temperature from 77 to 78, causing Abe to fall asleep. Also, why is your thermostat set at 77?
Oh, Jesus. Hot. Yeah.
God.
I thought too.
Ugh. I prefer like 68, but I get shot down all the time, so it has to be hotter or warmer than that.
I like it one more than that.
I mean, I do sometimes have it at 69 just for that joke, yes.
Sure, sure.
But 68 is the preferred temperature for this guy right here.
That's a good temperature. 68 is actually nice. Yes.
So Lisa agrees to go with Bart, but only if they can go with someone who knows how to fend off angry dogs. So they enlist the help of Crazy Cat Lady. She's going to be the hero of this episode, right? Mm-hmm. So she and Bart and Lisa hit the streets looking for Santa's little helper. So the cat lady points to the dog park, then bubbles incoherently. Subtitle show that says, "I can take you no further. Good luck, my friends." After some more gibberish, Bart and Lisa enter the park.
So back at Town Hall, Marge calls Abe to ensure that the kids are safe. But Grandpa says that they are not, because Bart has sass and Lisa thinks that she's the queen of the May. He then tells Marge to leave them with him to straighten them out. But Marge reminds him that she already did leave them with him. And so Hib asks, "Why the hell would you do that?"
Great scene. So at the dog park, Bart tries to quietly call for his best friends, squeaking a toy. And several dogs surround Bart and Lisa, led by the Alpha, who we discover is the tiny Taquito. Bart recognizes him as the dog that Milhouse got when he didn't wet the bed for a whole week. So
someday.
Yeah, someday. The Chihuahua gives Bart big puppy eyes, right? But then growls. So the pack steps closer to Bart and Lisa, and they climb a tree to safety. Bart tells his sister that they are about to die at the hands of a dog, and Lisa states that dogs have paws rather than hands. But that's like a saying, right? The dying at the hand of something.
Yeah.
I get what, you know. Anyways, Bart tells Lisa to remember that the last thing she ever did in life was correct him, which makes her feel better.
Yeah. Also, you know, he's probably confused because Homer was talking about doggy heaven and the dogs play harps with their hands. So it seems reasonable that he'd be confused. So I'm on Bart's side of this one. Usually I side with Lisa, but I think Bart's in the right.
They're both just dumb. Exactly. The boys of the Simpsons.
Mm-hmm. That's why we like him so much. So the pack of dogs snarl at a tree, including in the background you see Poochie swinging nunchucks. So Marge arrives on the scene saying that this has gone on long enough. Taquito barks at her and she tells him to sit. He growls, so Marge growls back. Taquito growls even harder, so Marge kicks him far, far, far into the air. And my wife has this amazing ability to walk in when I'm watching these episodes at the worst possible time. And so she just walked in to see Marge kick a dog, and she's like, "Jesus Christ," which I always think is funny.
Yeah, you know what's so funny is when I'm watching the episode, I'm thinking to myself, like, if it was me, I would just kick that dog. But they're not going to do that on The Simpsons. And then a second later, just Marge kicks the dog.
At the back of Marge, she was so funny.
Yeah. And, like, thinking, huh, Marge should probably just, like, be an NFL kicker because, like, dog launches so far.
Yeah, yeah. She could definitely.
I mean, a chihuahua. Yeah, a chihuahua is probably a lot lighter than a football or heavier than a football. So.
Yeah, Marge has got the legs.
I'm just thinking a new sport, chihuahua kicking.
A whole audience of cats. I could see this working.
Yeah, and squirrels.
So Marge apologizes, but the other dogs take notice. They all heal as Marge has become the alpha dog. As they all roll over, Marge states that she actually enjoys dogs.
Dogs are nice. I love dogs. Because in dogs, we see the things we wish we saw more of in people. Lifelong friendship, unwavering loyalty, and a willingness to eat anything you cook.
You rang?
Old Gil's here to save the day. Where are those out-of-control pooches? Sorry, old Gil. You're too late.
But I was supposed to redeem myself and finally earn the town's respect. Good job, Gil. You had to stop at the automat for an egg salad sandwich.
Well, at least you still have the sandwich.
I still want them to bring back the automat. There's a thing that existed before our time, which was if you went to, I'm referencing like Gil getting the egg salad sandwich at the automat. They were just like cafeterias, essentially. Like you would go into an automat and they just had refrigerators with slots where you put your money in and you pulled out and like there was your meal. So you had the kitchen behind the scenes making all this food. So you just go up and look in whatever you wanted, put the money in and pull it out. There you go. Genius idea, but it went away. I think fast food kind of drive-ins kind of like came about. Like it was more of like a city thing, right? Like an urban thing.
But I would love that. Like, as somebody who doesn't like to interact with people, it's a great idea. Like, you can just walk in, pay your money. It's like a vending machine with better food that you can walk inside of. It's a brilliant idea.
Someone bring back the automat, please.
Please, please. One more thing about that clip is I like that when Marge is talking about what the attributes of dogs that she likes, Homer shows up because, you know, in the early episodes, they talk about how Homer's basically just a dog. So I thought it was sweet that she was just, you know, Homer's like, hey, I'm here. I'm loyal and I'm ready to eat whatever you make.
Yeah. All right. Well, Marge returns the dogs to their rightful homes, starting with dropping Baz off at the Flanders, then a Dalmatian to the fire department, and she brings the hounds to Mr. Burns, who had to release June bugs while the dogs were away, and then a swarm of nuclear waste infested insects fly around Monty's head when going into his skull, causing it to glow neon green. Next, Marge returns a nude Willie to Skinner, who licks the face of the principal.
So the various dogs come back to their homes, including Santa's little helper, who is happy to be in the arms of Bart and Lisa. Snowball 2 appears from the bushes, and Lisa tells the cat that she'll have her day. Later, Gil walks the streets of Springfield, trying to cheer himself up. He hears a whimper and finds Taquito hiding in a shrub. Knowing the rough night that the dog had, he picks him up, and Taquito licks old Gil's face. Gil says that the dogs licked away a very bad day, and Taquito barks, and then we get subtitles that say, I wasn't licking, I was getting a taste for when you're dead. And that's our episode. All right, Craig, let's think about what we just saw, and take a little break, and we'll talk about it a bit more.
All right.
We'll be right back. Alrighty, Craig, we're back. Let's finish up our talk on Dogtown. We'll talk about the scenes that we liked, the people that made us laugh, and what we're watching next week. And we'll also give some gifts. But before we do that, I think you've got some an update for us.
Yeah, I did some research since Steve decided not to about The Purge and our Simpsons connection to The Purge. I think we could do it, Steve, because we have only a couple degrees to worry about. Okay. So, the movie The Purge was written and directed by James DeMonaco, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I looked back on his past, and this is pretty upsetting behavior, but I'll admit it for him. He also is the co-writer of a little movie called Jack, starring Robin Williams, directed by Francis Ford Coppola. Now, you know who's in that movie?
Who's that?
Besides, of course, Robin Williams, who never did a voice on The Simpsons. But that's okay, because Michael McKean is in the movie Jack. Wow. And Michael McKean has voice on The Simpsons, and he's Julio, right? A recurring character.
That's right.
So there you go. 2 degrees. The other actors that are in the movie Jack, did you know Jennifer Lopez is in the movie Jack?
No, I didn't, actually.
Has she done a voice on The Simpsons? I feel like she seems like someone who would have done a voice on The Simpsons.
I could see that, but I don't think she has, actually.
What about Fran Drescher, president herself? Fran Drescher?
She did,
yeah.
Yep, she was on the Treehouse of Horror, where she was befriending the Gollum.
The wonderful Bill Cosby's in this movie, Steve?
Man, that's the movie we need to talk about, is Jack.
Oh, well, that's supposed to be a horrible movie. I never saw it.
Yeah, neither did I. But, you know, it's got the Doctor in it.
And Diane Lane. I feel like, has Diane Lane ever done a voice on The Simpsons? For some reason, I could see, like, she has. I don't know.
Yeah, I can't recall, but I could also see that happening. Yeah, Diane Lane. Yeah.
But it doesn't look like it. I'm doing a quick rundown on. No, she's never done a voice on The Simpsons.
Well.
And double check the Jennifer Lopez. I don't think Jennifer Lopez is.
She's been referenced in Lisa Goes Gaga. She's mentioned, but that's it.
Okay. Well, at least we have the Michael McKean connection, so we can watch The Purge.
Well, that research that you did was quite the gift. Speaking of, we like to exchange gifts from this episode, something I thought you might like. And I've got two for you, one better than the other. One, I got you Bart's two kidneys. You can do with them what you will. And then I got you Gil's egg salad sandwich.
Gross. Ugh. I'll just have the kidneys.
That's the right response, yeah.
I got you a collector's item, Steve, from this episode.
Wow.
It's a one-of-the-kind gift that I think you'll cherish. This is the shoe that the shoe that Marge used to kick the taquito.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's
not the pair. It's just the one shoe that kicked the dog. So display it or smell it like you would, you weirdo.
Mm-hmm.
Any way you want it.
Me and my buddy Quentin are going to have quite a night. Well, thank you for that, Craig. What scenes made you laugh from this episode?
Well, I was kind of alluding to it in the episode talking about Nancy doing Bart with the hospital improvisation was great. And then Bart's sadness, of course, when Homer's trying to describe doggy heaven. The best performance as the Cockney boy in court. I'm going to just say, Nancy, you get my MVJ for this episode. Like, Bart's the MVJ for me because I just felt like the character of Bart was just really funny in this episode. Like, every scene, Bart scene was great. Homer, you know, was a close second, of course. And then Michael York as, what's that character's name?
Dr. Budgie.
Dr. Budgie is just also a very funny character because, like, knowing that these people, Springfield, are just lunatics, like, he's just trying to do his job and, like, telling people, like, no, this is wrong, what you guys are doing. Another fun character moment for him. But yeah, Bart. How about you?
I completely agree with you. Bart and Nancy's performance as Bart, always good. We always talk about how great Tress is, and she as the DPS, wonderful. She does some great voice work in this, but I think Bart and Nancy really shine in this episode, so I'm going to give it to Bart. There are some little jokes in here, like Mr. Burns quietly saying to repeal the child labor laws in addition to the dog laws. Really funny. Chalmers just shooting Gil, the fact that the gun was in the school's lost and found. Very funny. But yeah, Bart is my MBJ as well. Really good. But what did you think of the episode as a whole, Craig?
Yeah, I had a lot of fun watching this episode. It's, again, silly premise, but it just feels like at this point in time, in the last, like, I want to say 20 years, it seems like the dog culture in America has become, like, too many people referring to their dogs as, like, their kids, that type of thing. And if you do it, listeners, okay, I'm not judging you. I'm just saying, like, this is kind of where we're at. dogs are more special than people now, which you kind of see all over this country, maybe the world.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a fun premise to work off of. And that's what's kind of fun about this episode. You'd start off with Gil getting hit by Homer, and then him coming in thinking that he's the one who has to save the day. It's a nice, like, nice bookend, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I enjoyed it. It's up there. Not like up there, but you know, it's over the mid tier. It's out of the mid zone, which is good, which is what you want to be.
Yeah.
If I gave this a ranking, look, we have the Chihuahua there. Chihuahuas can average to the, 12 to 20 years. So, between 12 and 20, I'll give this episode, the age Steve prefers dogs to be dead, 13.
Okay. I'm somehow relieved that you didn't make a pedophile joke, but also come off as a horrible person, so I like it.
All right. Oh, one more thing. We already said it in the episode, but Marge is also a close second for MBJ because of just the kick. The kick was the best scene in the episode.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, this is a very interesting episode. For one, it is the season finale, and I think what it does well is it's a very cinematic episode. Like, it feels like a big thing is happening. You don't have a B plot. You just have this one big thing, and they cut right to the chase. They don't even have time to finish the intro of the episode, and Homer's already stuck in traffic, and then he ends up in Garbage Alley, and boom, he hits Gil, and the episode just starts rolling, and it doesn't stop. I appreciate that. It's a very quickly paced episode, and a lot happens, and it's very action-packed, and I like that. It is, like, a weird, goofy premise. It's a bold move. I don't know that, like, I would have thought about this, and so it's interesting. I also kind of appreciate the fact that it doesn't have, like, an inherently pro or anti-dog status as an episode.
Mm-hmm.
Like, dogs are just doing what dogs would do, and it doesn't really offer judgment to it, and I kind of like that, because people like the dogs, but also the dogs just are behaving like animals, because at the end of the day, that's what they are. And also having Dr. Budgie being the voice of reason, just being like, hey, y'all are idiots, this is what we should do, and then they lock him up for it, is very Springfield, and I like that they kept with that. I had a lot of fun with this one. It is, like, maybe not, like, the best episode ever, but I think, you know, from an era that, like, I wasn't watching it, I'm kind of bummed that I missed this in the moment, because it is a lot of fun. So I like this. I'm thinking positive things about it. I approve. And so, you know, they talk about doggy heaven, and as we all know, all dogs go to heaven, which was a movie and then a sequel, but there's also an All Dogs Go to Heaven TV series starring Dom DeLuise, Steven Weber, Sheena Easton, and Ernest Borgnine, and Charles Nelson Reilly, and B.B. Newworth, and our beloved Tress MacNeille, and Kevin Michael Richardson. So we could watch it if we wanted to.
Oh, boy.
And that series had inexplicably 41 episodes. So I'm going to give this a solid 35 out of 41.
Yeah, that's a good score. It's a really good score.
I like this a lot. But will we like what we're watching next week? And, well, Craig, I've got some good news for you. We don't need that lovable Wheel of Random, because we got a new one.
Ooh.
Going back to season 35, episode 13, what do you think the title is?
I'm going to stick with the dog theme here. I'm talking all about dogs in this episode. So I'm going to think, Simpsons parody, famous movies, of course. One movie that has a dog that everyone likes, and I'm assuming the dog probably dies at the end of the movie, and that's Marley and Me. Ooh. So I'm going to go with Margie and Me.
Ah, that sounds like fun. Does Marge die at the end?
Sure. Why not?
Sadly, Craig, that is not the title, although I would like to watch that.
In that episode, a dog kicks Marge.
I would like to see that, actually. Just because I think that Marge would kick well, because,
yeah,
like, the way that her body's shaped, she would, like, rotate well. I think it'd be interesting if, like, a golden retriever just, like if Air Bud kicked her, it'd be fun to watch.
Mm-hmm.
No, the episode for next week is entitled Clan of the Cave Mom. You did get it right that it does involve, presumably, a mom.
All right, so Springfield learns of this new trend by this, like, Opal or something like that. One of those, like, fictional celebrity characters, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the new trend is to start raising your family in caves with other moms, other families, to bring about the idea of, like, society, bringing people back together like the olden times with the cave people, you know, starting like the your clan then. For a week, The Simpsons with like other moms like Luann and Helen Lovejoy, they all take Bart and Lisa and like learn community values and things like that in a cave. Meanwhile, the men go out and do hunter-gathering things.
Makes a lot of sense, and it does feel like that would be a trend that like a women's magazine or a TV show like Opal would do. So here's what we have. A parenting disagreement between Marge and Luann Van Houten escalate into a life-or-death struggle for survival.
I mean, it kind of sounds like it, but I guess we have to find out, though.
Yeah, you might be right, and we might have to end this podcast, but we don't know now.
No.
So we'll just have to you'll just have to tune in next week and listen to us talk about the episode, and we hope that you do. And also, we hope that you contact us on Instagram or on YouTube at 13Simpsons. And hey, if that doesn't work for you, you can always email us at 13Simpsons@gmail.com.
And if you don't want to use your typey types, your fingers, use your mouthy mouth on us. We'd love to have your mouth on us. Mm-hmm. And that is by leaving us a voicemail, Steve. So you go to the podcatching app, wherever you listen to this to, you just click on the show's notes and it says leave a voicemail. And that's what you do. You just click that button and assuming you're listening to us on a smart device, leave us a message. Also, on your smart device, like Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your fine podcasts, leave us a review, 5-star or the equivalent, but you don't need to leave a real review. Just let us know how far you can kick a chihuahua.
That's right. And hey, if you want, you can go to tpublic.com/user/annoyedgruntboy and get yourself a great piece of merch from the Annoyed Grunt Boys. I currently, at the moment, am wearing my favorite Peanuts Can Kill shirt, and there's so many others, so check it out and be cool like your Annoyed Grunt Boys, Steve and Craig. All right, for this week, I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Steve.
And I've been Annoyed Grunt Boy Craig.
And remember, I thought I was a town failure.
I smell like lamb.
About dog heaven.
I died for 5 minutes and was sent there by mistake. Now leave me alone.